Yeah, these are all the three IDEs, integrated development environment. Something when we speak about language or a software, we need an environment. Like if I want to present something, I need a PowerPoint or Microsoft Word to type something and to explain or narrate something. Similarly, if you want to write a program, then that program need to be compiled and executed. Input need to be fed and output need to be seen. For this, all those activity in the computer science field, for any language or for every language, there will be n number of IDEs, integrated development environment. So there, any one IDE we may need to stick to execute our program to feed the input and to see the output, something like that. So Spyder is part of Anaconda software. Jupyter Notebook is also part of Anaconda 3 software. Both will work. Spyder behavior is like a compiler. It is different way it functions. Jupyter Notebook, which will behave in terms of cells, each cell we can do a line of codes or piece of codes. Immediately we can see the output. It's like a interpreter, we can say. For every command, then and there we can see the output. It's a kind of micro programming. We can do a micro level and we can confirm whether our program works well or not, then we can proceed further. So across the globe, Jupyter Notebook is widely used software. The next is PyCharm. The third is Spyder. If we don't have sufficient memory capacity or a good configuration of the machine, then we no need to worry. We can use Kaggle Notebook or Google Colab Notebook. These are all online IDE. If you wish, I will explain you. When it comes to deep learning, I promised to Pooja Madam for image recognition also, image analysis also, for the medical image applications. You need a deep learning. Whenever deep learning, if you are using high-end machine, need to be used. Otherwise, the machine will go down, something crash may happen also. We should not attempt deep learning with the low configuration machines. By the time Google Colab is preferable. Let me introduce both Kaggle Notebook, Google Colab in due course of time. Because these are all online IDEs, anywhere, anytime we can code and we can show and we can discuss with any of our friends. Rather than even collaboratively, we can work together also on a single Colab notebook. More than one person can work together. These are all the added advantage. Somewhere we may go and we may forget to carry a laptop. By the time, these are all the online IDEs will help us to code and fulfill the requirements. Next, data where to get for consistent or continuous progress or to do lot of project. We may feel excited after knowing certain concept, then where can I get data? How can I apply the logic on different data set? How can I analyze data? By that time, you may have a lot of curiosity. So we need to look at Kaggle. Kaggle has all the variety of data, business data, financial data, health data, all current kind of data, even lot many other aspects. Ion properties, they have collected whatever the types of ion available on the planet Earth across the globe, then which ion can resist for the rest, something like that competition they have hosted. Kaggle has varied variety of data, so many variety. Rather than if you ask for health domain data alone, I want more, then Kaggle is not the place. It will help you all the variety of data, but not one specific domain data. The next is GitHub. GitHub, try to log in with your Gmail account, both for Kaggle. For this, the website is www.kaggle.com. Naturally, your knowledge will be growing day by day when you visit these kind of websites each and every day. Next, GitHub, you can just type in the Google GitHub. Already these slides I have sent you. Just type the name Kaggle, GitHub, the Google, it will take you to that website, the corresponding home URL. Then you can log in with your Gmail ID. That's more than enough to work with Kaggle and GitHub. Kaggle is a product of Google only. So you can log in with Gmail. It's user friendly. UCI Machine Learning Repository. This has more medical data. It's very good website for medical data, both image and data. So it has diabetic analysis, so many diseases, so many kind of epidemics, so much data, voluminous of data available related to medical sphere. Other data sets are little bit lesser, but it is available. UCI has also wide variety of data set. But each variety restricted to very minimal, predominantly medical data, image data, medical, like normal data. Yesterday we have seen some data, na, categorical, numerical data, something like that data set is available. Now we may need to look at a few terminologies. Once these terminologies are seen, we move to the next topic of discussion. Model. Anything we talk in terms of machine learning, we will use model rather than algorithm. Normally, computer science field people used to call algorithm predominantly, program predominantly, interchangeably. Whereas when we come to data science, maximum or uniformity, people will maintain all the data analyst, they will call it as a model. Yesterday, we have discussed the supervised learning algorithm. And within supervised, we have seen classification and regression. These all the things. Whenever we say classification model, regression model, why we say it is a model is, it's a full of mathematical representation of a real world process. For the learning or machine learning, that mathematical notations helps predominantly in order to predict something based on the training data set. So it has a relationship between the given input data and the taken output. So that it is called model. 1 minute. I will clear this. 1 minute. Hold on for a minute. Yeah, algorithm. The top I couldn't able to see. I will reduce the size.
You can use Control Shift Alt H. It will hide.
Okay, sir. Yeah, algorithm. A set of rules used to make a calculation or to solve certain problem is said to be algorithm. Then training. Yesterday we have seen candidate number 1, candidate number 2, candidate number 3. 3 data I started giving you. Their IQ level, their number of study hours, their plus 2 mark. These 3 parameters I gave. Not only this, dependent variable also I gave. UG mark of the first 3 candidate also I gave. Naturally you started predicting the result of UG or performance of UG for the 4th candidate. So that these 3 data which helps for learning or predicting is termed as training. That's it. So in the previous case or yesterday discussion, both that labeling model, UG itself, we started discussing labels, the grade, ABC grade, or we started discussing 85, 80, 75, something like that. Where, although we use numerical, this is also said to be dependent variable or predictive variable. This is also UG performance. We use labels, that is also termed as dependent variable or predictive variable or UG performance. Whenever we start predicting the label, it is called classification. Whenever we start predicting the numerical value or continuous value, it is called regression. That we should remember. The moment we use the numerical value. For the fourth candidate also, we were trying to predict 78 marks something. This numerical prediction for the dependent variable, when it plays a role, it is called regression. The three data set which helps for training or for learning, that is called training data. The training data merely helps for learning. Machine learning predominantly learns through data. Data is the prime source of learning. Not a mathematical model. The prime source of machine learning is a data. That we should always remember. So that's why the data set is classified into two different data set: train data set, test data set. Train data set will allow to learn the machine. Test data set will be helpful for prediction. Rather, one more way also I can say, I am trying to give pass fail. Here I am trying to give pass fail. The first candidate passed in the UG. Second candidate also passed. Third candidate failed. Pass fail. It is two class variable. ABC is termed as three class variable, multi class variable. It could be anything. The moment we use label, then it is called classification. The data which helps for learning or helps for machine learning, helps for human learning, whatever, it's called training data set. The moment the predictive parameter becomes numerical, it is called regression. The moment the predictive parameter becomes label, it is called classification. These all we may need to be thorough on. Target variable, one more terminology I am bringing here. Please bear with all the terminologies, I cannot do anything. So this predictive variable, dependent variable, or it is called predictive variable, or it is called target variable, all are same. The moment dependent variable, predictive variable, target variable, all are interchangeably used, or these kind of algorithm or these kind of models are said to be supervised learning models. That's it. Then test data set. What is test data set? What you were predicting yesterday, the fourth candidate. I will give these three parameters: IQ of the person, study hours, and +2 mark. But you would be in the position to predict well ahead about UG performance based on these three data. Test data set, otherwise it is called Y variable also. Dependent, otherwise called Y variable. Please remember these four terminology. Y variable, or every day when you participate in the session, you can take a notebook and you can make a note of it also. Dependent variable, Y variable, predictive variable, target variable. All the four represents same. For the test data, this value will not be available. Y value will not be available. Dependent variable will not be available. Predictive variable will not be available. Target variable will not be available. Your machine need to predict this value. That prediction, again, it may be a categorical data or it may be a numerical data. When it becomes categorical data, classification algorithm. When it becomes a numerical data, regression algorithm. This we should remember. And the feature, also known as independent variable or predictor variable. A feature is an observable, that's all. If a feature is what? A column, otherwise called feature. That's more than enough. Every column stands for a feature. Yesterday we discussed. Again, we may need to recap few things, then we can move on to the next slide. Column or attribute or parameter or variable or feature. these all same. Similarly, row, record, instance, observation. These all we need to remember. Dependent variable, otherwise called Y variable. It could be a capital Y or small y, that doesn't matter. Predictive variable or target variable. And remaining all are called independent variable. Naturally, it is called mathematically X variables. These all we may need to remember every time when we look into every model. Overfitting, temporarily, I don't want to speak anything. After discussing any one model only, a right or appropriate time to introduce about overfitting this word. Right now, we no need to talk about, maybe 3 to 5 hours it would take to use the word overfitting. That's it. So today the agenda of discussion: descriptive statistics, inferential statistics, introduction to Python if possible. Otherwise, I would be stopping with the descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. It's a kind of revisiting our previous knowledge, school days knowledge or childhood knowledge. That's it. So these are all the foundation for learning any model which is provided in the machine learning or data analytics domain. So we may need to revisit what is descriptive statistics, inferential statistics, then we slowly get into Python. Yesterday for sample or for namesake, we have seen a data set, a Excel file. Let us see a formal formal definition of data. Data is often viewed as a lowest level of abstraction from which information or knowledge are derived. Very lowest level of abstraction. For example, age. I can write age 25. That would not give any meaning at all. If we look at the data alone, what is this? Your screen sharing is paused. Kannan sir? Kannan sir? Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Your screen sharing is paused. It's coming, sir. What that?
You just have to, again, one second.
Resume.
Resume, yeah. Just press resume.
No, sir, it's not coming.
Okay, do one thing. Stop sharing.
Okay, sir.
And then again, you can start sharing.
Yeah. Thank you.
No problem.
Data is the lowest level of abstraction. For example, if you write age 25, 32, 15, if you look at this data alone, nothing we can able to infer without any association meaning. We cannot infer anything. It's a kind of lowest level of abstraction. When we give an attribute name, age, then it becomes little more meaningful. If I give description, this is the age group of something, some domain or apartment, something like that. If I specify what exactly, from where exactly I'm collecting this date, then it will become much more meaningful. But when we look at the 25 alone, it's a kind of low-level abstraction. We may not able to take anything. Data can be number, words, measurements, observation, or description. It could be a detailed description. Then when anything described in terms of English, then again machine learning algorithm will help. That is called NLP, natural language processing. even with a text description, machine can learn, machine can interpret, machine can do something, it can take decision, it can act upon the model. So it's, if I give machine learning algorithm this entire paragraph or slide, it can do something, it can predict something, it can categorize something, it can classify something. That domain is called NLP. This is again branch of machine learning. Even a figure, a fact can be a data. When the complexity of data goes more and more, we may need to apply different strategies, different algorithms and model. Data on its own carries no meaning. That's what I said. 25 alone, you cannot tell anything. What is this 25? It could be your mark, it could be your salary, or it could be your age. We don't know, cannot be given anything. We may need to give additional information for the interpretation. Raw table, it's a collection of random info or data, that's it. So just to be started with the data definition, then we need to go few things already I started giving you, let it be. We may need to understand type of the data, what variable, features or attributes are included. All are same, variable, attribute, features. What information are we getting? The moment we come into data science or any new data is given to you, you may need to understand how many variables are there, what is the meaning of each variable, and what that signifies, what information we need to do further analyze, how we need to analyze that all. First, we need to understand this. Next, we need to understand what is the format of the variable. Every variable, yesterday we started a little bit discussion, whether it is of categorical or string or numerical, both are same meaning only, string or categorical are same. One more way, in Python world, they will say object also or string, all are same. By this time, you may be aware of what is categorical, grading A, grading B, grading C, pass, fail, gender, male and female, these all fall into categorical data type. All the three words are used interchangeably, categorical, object, and string. Yes, subtle difference. Purely string will have full of alphabet, whereas object, if one alphabet is used, it becomes object. That you should be understanding a subtle difference, but there is no majorly or in the higher plane, there is no big difference. What type of variable, whether it is categorical, continuous or discrete? Is this data comes from sample or population? Because if the data comes from population, different meaning, sample, different meaning. Again, during our childhood or when we started learning statistics, we would have come across the sample and population. For this, one more little bit example also we can do. When a person starts cooking bowl of rice or Maggi noodles, whatever, we will be finalizing the taste and boiling point of the item which we are cooking. We sample through one spoon. If this sample is certified, everything is okay or properly boiled, then we stop cooking. We stop everything. We will not sit and eat the entire bowl of item what we are cooking. We will sample it. If sample is okay or perfect, the information or inference is applied upon the entire population. Assumed that the entire population, it is going well. Same, it is applicable for sample and population. Suppose any one of you discovering a new medicine, that medicine you cannot apply across all the patients who are all suffering with that ailment on in the entire globe. You cannot do. You will be drawing 20 patients or 30 patients in your locality or in your district or in the country level, and you will prescribe that medicine and you will observe the progress in their health condition. that you will apply to the entire population, it works well. My medicine works much better than the existing medicine for this disease. This kind of thing, whatever we do, it's called sample and population. Types of data are variable. Slowly we are formally coming into whatever we discussed yesterday randomly, that all coming in the formal way of discussion. Categorical. What is categorical? Tell your favorite color. You will be telling purple, you will be telling blue, you will be telling white, you will be telling black. So your favorite color is a kind of name, it's a kind of string. So it's a categorical data. Place of birth, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Chennai. Types of car, Toyota, BMW, Audi, something like that you will tell. So everything is said to be a categorical data. Discrete data, shoe size, number of brothers, that is represented. Age is also discrete data. Your weight also discrete data. For 25 years, 45 kg. Continuous data. Height, mass, length, these all said to be continuous data. Now, majorly any variable, any column or any attribute if you look at, it fall into two categories, either discrete data or continuous data. Continuous data means that 80.5 or your marks 80 also. Mark column always continuous. Mark of the student or a particular class, it starts from 0 to 100. It's a continuous data. It could be anything. It could be 0.5, 99.5, anything. Again, discrete data categorized into two different variety. Nominal data, ordinal data. Anything which we describe through English, nationality, your district, place of birth, favorite food, favorite color, types of car, favorite person, favorite actor. These all comes under nominal. Ordinal data, arranging, rating of your workshop feedback, 0 to 5. Ordinal, 0 stands for low or high, whatever, 5 stands for that opposite, ordered. Then 1 to 7, day 1 of the week, day 2 of the week, day 3 of the week, ordered. Month 1 to 12, first month of the year, third month of the year, something like that. Whenever it comes in the orderly form, it's called ordinal data. Whenever it comes in the naming form, it's called nominal data. Simple, we can remember name kind, anything kind of name, your favorite flower, nominal. Anything comes in terms of order, ordered arrangement, it becomes ordinal. What is statistics? It's a science of collecting data, organizing data. Collecting data itself, central limit theorem we may need to use. We may need to use the concept of whether we are working for sample or population, and what is the size of the sample, what is the size of the population, everything we need to statistically look through. Organizing the data while we were collecting, we may do very random order or haphazard manner, whatever we want, it will be doing, but we may need to organize the data. Presenting the data, analyzing the data, interpreting the numerical data to assist in making more effective decision. We can apply any theory, like or any model, ANOVA model, T-test, F-test, Z-test, anything we can apply, that is easier. But we may need to take decision what kind of test we need to apply for the given circumstances and for the available data. There again, the intellectual effort is required. Once if we have confirmed, depending upon the given problem statement, depending upon the given data set, two we need to look at together. We need to look at data also. We need to look at problem statement also. Then we need to decide the statistical approach or statistical model or machine learning model, any model. We need to take decision or select a model. Once model is ready, you have applied. Recently, there is no big challenge for applying model. Understanding the phenomena underneath every model only lagging. In a fraction of second, recent day, we can use any kind of tools and programs which is existing in the world. GitHub provides program or code for any kind of data science and statistical model. Just we need to copy paste and customize how we need to give our input, how we need to take our output. But we should know what kind of model to be applied. That is where the intellect is required recent days, not in writing coding, not in compiling the model. Once model is applied, results are produced. We must be in the position to interpret results. Totally, our expertise where it is required is selecting the model based on what data and what problem statement and interpretation of the result. The entire world, data analyst, these two capability only people are expecting, industry also expecting, not in building the model. For that, lot of tools available recent days, SPSS, SAS, so many tools, R language, R code, Python code, ready-made code, everything is available. Lot of tools, customized tools, licensed tools also available. Just if you push the data and tell the model, it gives the results. But there is no fantastic work has been done for the interpretation of results and data storytelling and for decision making until there is no such beautiful tools available. This is where our data science role still exists, the job is existing. Up to this, nothing. Nowadays, it's a very simple matter. What is the result? How can I interpret? Should I change other model or should I stop the model? That is where the data analyst role is more today. Again, statistics, descriptive statistics, inferential statistics. What is descriptive? Finding mean of the mean age or average age of my apartment. Average age group of students in a class. Normally it would be same. Individual age may be 18. The class average age also nearby 18 only. Nothing more big changes will come. For the given data, applying a model or statistical measures, finding the result, concluding or decision making need to be done whatever the results we have obtained. If we do like that, it is called descriptive. One such example is mean. Similarly, mode. Similarly, median. Again, we will touch upon these all. Let us wait for temporarily. When we do these all, mean, mode, median, we will take a data, we will apply these all, mean, mode, median, whatever. Then the result will be obtained. From the result, directly you will conclude or you will infer something. That's all. No more discussion, no more thought. We have a data, we will apply descriptive statistics, predominantly descriptive statistics or mean, mode, median, interquartile range, few more are there. Let us discuss later. No need to worry. We apply this statistical measure on the given data set. We obtain the result. Through the obtained result, we will infer something. Then the inference is going to be final or rejection or acceptance, whatever. But we will infer something. That is called descriptive statistics. What is inferential statistics? Study patterns, randomness, and uncertainty in the data. Used to draw inferences about the process or population being studied. Used to make conclusion and future prediction by analyzing numerical data. I'll give one simple example. Already I mentioned I have discovered a medicine, a new medicine. That medicine I may not be able to apply to the entire suffering community. I will draw 25 patient samples across India. At least I will maintain the consistency across India. It's a countrywide study. Then whatever I am observing with these patients, I am writing a report, or I am having the observation or the cure, whatever may be, cure or failure, success, whatever. This entire process is called sample. This I'm inferring to the population. I'm applying, I'm extending to the set called population. This kind of thing is said to be inferential statistics, population. For example, I'm an Amazon business owner. I am studying the pattern of trend of business or trend of purchase only in Hyderabad. I am categorizing how the female wear selling proportion, or male wear, or kitchenware, or electronic gadgets, whatever. Finally, I analyze these all up to 2018. Then I will conclude the same will extend for the 2020 also. This is also called inferential. I'm working up to the data 2015 to 2018 data I'm considering for the Hyderabad zone. And within the Hyderabad zone, I am analyzing upon so many categories of goods and services. Whatever it gives the results or interpretation, I'm extending to the year 2020 also. This is also example for inferential statistics. I infer something, that inference I'm applying for further study or for the population. It's called inferential statistics. Then inferential statistics otherwise said to be estimation and hypothesis testing. What is estimation? Point estimation, interval estimation. We will be discussing again in the further slides. We no need to worry. Hypothesis testing. What estimation is directly considering the data, using any of the model, finding out one inference, one statistical value. We will use the data, we will apply the model, then we will obtain one result. For example, 8.5 something, 8.5, 2.0 or 0.8, something we will get, either or I'm telling. With this obtained value, we take some conclusion, we take some decision. That is called point estimation. Whereas hypothesis testing, it is little bit different. What that signifies, you may be aware also. There are two hypotheses. Null hypothesis represented as HO. Alternative hypothesis represented as HA. HO. What we are trying to tell? Diet pattern influences intelligence of the person. Diet has no impact. We need to write the word no. No impact on the IQ. We need to collect data, we need to prove this. Alternative hypothesis. Yes, the diet pattern influences the IQ power of the person. Yes. That's it. We need to gather data. We need to choose the model, statistical model or machine learning model. Then we need to calculate or infer the result. What that result says, depending upon that, either your HO will be true or your HA will be true. Based on that, you need to take a judgment or conclusion report, which is right. This kind of situation is said to be hypothesis testing. Again, it is a little bit of vast topic. We will touch upon when the statistics comes into your matter. Temporarily, we are introduced with HO and HA. HO stands for there is no relationship. Anything it could be, diet, I am giving one scenario. This medicine has no impact on this patient. This medicine has impact on this patient. Any of the problem statement can be considered, could be considered. Even weight, obesity, directly, obesity doesn't have any relationship with IQ. Obesity has relationship with IQ. You can sit and prove this statement. It could be one of your research study also. Blood relation, even I was having one potential problem in my head, but I couldn't able to collect data. I couldn't get any cooperation from my, colleague side. Blood group has influence in the logical reasoning skill. I was trying to do, blood group has impact on the logical thinking. Logical thinking means program and coding. A very good coder, we are telling in the computer science, no? So whether that guy has a good coding skill or not, for that what makes difference. So for now, I had undergone 150 students in Hyderabad, where I work. I got connected with 4 engineering institution. I'm working for 4 engineering institution. Out of that 4 engineering institution, I collected, I have seen the samples of more than 300 students. Out of that, whomever gets high package job and whomever appreciated by the teacher, he is having good coding skill, those are all B positive. Next is O positive. These two people only doing well with the coding. I have observed only for 150 students, or I can say that this is proved for only 100, probably 100 students, that's it. I'm waiting for across India also, across globe also. Scientifically also need to be measured. For that, rigorous test need to be conducted. And what is the way I am not able to conclude is, any number of students, for example, if I look at 100 students data, out of that 50 students are B positive. The remaining predominance are O positive. Next, things are very minor. Because of this kind of largest occurrences or instances creates that impact, are naturally B positive tend to have good coding skill. I'm totally puzzled. This is one of the research attempt I wanted to do. I wish, it's my wish I'm just expressing with you. Similarly, you can do for pharmacology also, economics also, anything. So here what I should do when I use hypothesis testing is, I need to formulate HO. There is no relationship between the blood group and the programming skill. Alternative hypothesis, there is a relationship between blood group and the programming skill. I need to make a statement. I need to collect the data. N attribute I need to keep in my mind. I need to collect the data. I need to apply the appropriate model. What model works for this analysis? I should be good enough, or I should discuss with the expert, or I should be the expert. Then this data and the model together should work. Then it should give me the result. That result I need to look at. Then depending upon the result, I need to take decision whether HO is true or HA is true for this particular analysis. This is called hypothesis testing. Is that okay? May I proceed? Today, more monotone is going on. I am only keep on talking. So just I wanted to intervene. Please raise question or express your thoughts so far now. Hello?
Hello, yes.
Yeah, Mohammed sir, yeah, please.
Regarding the GitHub, you told like we can directly copy those programs, right?
Yeah, yes, sir.
So we don't need to learn. How does that work? Like,
yeah, that is where we need to learn what is the model. Mm-hmm. That's what I was telling, no? Interpretation of the results. These two skills only nowadays you require, sir. Nothing more you would require. Being a student also, being a researcher. And another thing, if you really fond of doing by your own, you are permitted to do. Don't worry. Nobody stops also.
Okay.
Yeah, it's your wish whether you want to be a contributor or you want to be a utilizer. That is your choice. You may think in different way, you may use different code, and you can look at in different perspective. Anything you can do on data science field, choice is yours.
Okay.
Hello, ma'am. Rajini here.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm sorry, I was a bit late because of poor connection here.
No,
I just wanted to ask you, ma'am, this.
Yeah.
I just wanted to ask you, you said about Kaggle, right?
Yeah.
Is it a database or any kind of data is available in this?
I will explain you, ma'am. Kaggle?
Yeah.
Kannan sir?
Okay. Yeah.
Can you explain about Kaggle to madam?
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
So basically Kaggle is a portal, madam. I'll just show it to you.
Yes, sir.
Madam, can you stop sharing the screen?
Yes, sir. At least this 5-10 minutes I can relax. That's why. Thank you.
Okay. Kaggle is first of all a portal that is primarily focused on data things. Okay. So it is primarily having a repository of data in different fields. Okay.
Okay.
So most of these modern portals, be it Kaggle, be it GitHub, or any other portals, they keep it as a community where people try to contribute to others. Okay, for example, I am a matured machine learning expert, so I would like to disseminate information to other people. So what I would do is I will create a channel on this and I will share my programs, my data, everything. Okay. Same is the case with GitHub. So GitHub also is, GitHub serves multiple purposes. In a technical terminology, GitHub is a version control system. You can compile multiple versions and keep it there. It can also be treated as a repository, which is nothing but a safekeeping of your files. Okay. So, for example, most book writers, for example, there's a data science book, they will put the code on the GitHub so that you can take it and use it freely. Okay.
Oh.
So I'll show you both GitHub and Kaggle, how you can actually benefit from it. Okay.
And then you can emphasize about Kaggle competitions also.
Yeah, I will do that. Yes, Rajini madam, you're saying something.
Sir, the thing is, I just wanted to ask, what is the difference between R and Python, sir?
Okay, so that's altogether different question. So as madam was already telling you, there are different languages you can use for data science and machine learning.
Yes.
And predominantly the most frequently used and the number of users that are extremely high, you have Python first, then you have R, then we have Excel, SAS, SPSS, MATLAB. Open source version of MATLAB is called Octave. Okay.
Java also.
Yeah, Java, Scala. These are the top languages. Okay. Java, Scala. And there are n number of languages. We are talking about the most popular languages.
Yes.
Out of this, R and Python are open source.
Okay.
These are also open source. Whereas Excel, SAS, SPSS, MATLAB, they are proprietary software. You have to pay for it. So there is free version available, but that's only for a trial purpose, or it will have some limitations. Okay. So coming to the difference between Python and R, R originally appeared as what is called a replacement for S language. Okay. So S is a very, very useful statistical program that came long time back, more than 20 years back, but predominantly it was used by academicians and research scholars. So the programming community was not able to use it. So to fill this gap, they created a tool called R. So it sounded similar to S, okay? S and R. So R can be thought of as more of a statistical program.
Okay.
Primarily, its strength is statistical capability, but it can do all the other things as well. So you can do a general purpose programming. You can do transformations, data collection, okay, visualization. So like that, there are many things. Okay, how Python has an edge over R generally is because Python is a broad spectrum language. You can do almost anything with Python. You can do front end development. You can do testing utilities. You can create a test bench. You have deep learning. You have NLP. You have image processing. You have chatbot libraries. So almost any kind of thing you want, you can have it in Python. At the same time, it can also act as a general purpose program. Okay, so that is one major difference. R lacks most of these things. Okay, so R, you cannot create front end. Suppose I want to create a website, I cannot use R. But Python has Django framework, you can use that. Okay, so that is one major difference. Second major difference is that initially R was only meant for single system usage. That means it cannot work with distributed system. Okay, so in distributed systems, R cannot be used. So the amount of data it can process was very limited initially. But now, the last 4 years, the things have changed. Hadoop and Spark, they support R now. Hadoop has R-Hadoop integration. And Spark works with Python, R, Java, and also Scala. So that difference is slightly going away now. But still, functionality-wise, Python beats R by a big term. Okay, so that is one major thing that you will be seeing in the difference between Python and R. Okay. All right. So. Anything else?
Nothing, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So if you see here, what you can use Kaggle for? First of all, it has tons of data sets. Any kind of field you go, you will have to use data sets for your testing and verifications. So there will be lots and lots of data. Okay, so you can put some search. For example, I want to have weather data. Okay. So you can see city-wise, state-wise, there will be weather data available. And it's also normally a collection of data, real data. It is not fake data. It's real data collected over many years. Okay.
Okay.
So most often people work with financial data.
Yes, sir.
Like credit card information, banking information. So all these things will be there. Okay. So recently what I'm seeing is if somebody wants to publish a paper, what they do is they take a very big data set, which has like 1 million records or more.
Yes, exactly.
And try to use this as the source for their research. Okay. That is one aspect of Kaggle. The second aspect is that it supports a lot of workbooks. As madam was telling, the workbooks are now called as notebooks. Okay, you can see there are a lot of notebooks available. Okay, so most of these notebooks are specific problems that are solved using different languages. You can have a notebook for Python, you can have a notebook for R also. So a lot of these notebooks are very, very exhaustive in nature in terms of providing solutions. Okay. So since COVID is very popular, you can see a lot of examples on that. Okay. So this is the second thing that you can use it for. Then they also organize courses. Okay. So the courses that are offered in Kaggle are very, very standard courses. They are very good quality courses. And a lot of courses have been announced recently. And above all these things, you also have competitions, okay? So, which are called as hackathons, okay? So you can participate in these competitions. They regularly organize problem statements, which carry a prize with that, okay? So for example, University of Liverpool is giving a competition with a total prize of $25,000, okay? So here is where a lot of software engineers and budding engineers and scientists and academicians, they try to prove their prowess. They will try to showcase their strength in programming. So this is a good area where you can motivate your students and also you can motivate your colleagues as well. 1 second, I'll close the door.
Hello, please be quiet.
So the way the learning is happening these days is more through awareness. Okay, so we will be failing in our duty if we do not expose our students with upcoming portals mainly. Okay, so especially competitions, what are the new technologies, what is actually being in vogue in the industry. So all these things we should get familiar and tell our students also. Okay, so that is very, very important. So you have to expose your students to these competitions and motivate them to join these competitions. Initially, they'll just join and may fail, but eventually they'll get very, very interested and they will definitely win prizes also. Okay, so that is another thing. Same way you have the, this one, what is called the GitHub. So one request I'm making is, if you are teaching any students in development work or coding work, ask them to submit all their assignments through GitHub only. Do not ask them to submit in a notebook or paper. Ask them to submit in GitHub. So once they get motivated and interested in GitHub, so they will start rocking. Okay. So GitHub, how I use it is, I use it as my repository. I have my own code in the repository. I also search code. For example, let us say I want to work on pharmacological problem. Okay. So I want to get some code in pharmacology. Okay. So these are the outputs I'm getting. I can choose which language I want to use. So do I want the solutions in Python? Do you want it in R or Jupyter Notebook like that? Okay, let us say I want it in Jupyter Notebook. So once you click on the link, you can see 10 results. So you just right click and open anything of your interest, or you can do everything. So here is a curve fitting program for experimental pharmacology data. So if it interests you, you right click and open it in a new tab. The easiest thing to do is go to this green button which says clone or download. Okay, if you have an account, it will clone, otherwise it will download. Okay, so these are the data. Normally people also give you some notes here. Okay, so this is the small notes they write. Okay, so you can simply say clone or download. So it will open this thing and you can say download zip file. So it is downloaded. So now what you can do is you can take this to your portal. I'm sorry, your folder where you have all your code. And paste it there. And then you can extract it and start using it. So now it's available. These are all the files that are there. You can see a lot of Python notebooks. I'm going to open it now. So this is one of the examples that they have posted. So it gives you the complete notebook. It gives you the data output, their comments, the print of the statements, everything is there. Mostly it will come with all the charts as well. Okay. So that's how you can utilize it. And also if you have started distributing code, or if you are teaching students and you want to share the code, you can share it as a repository. So all you have to do is create an account by signing in, and then create a repository and post your code there. Okay, so I'll send you a document that tells you how you can share the code. Okay, so that's very, very useful. Okay, so these are two things. And another important place where you can get competition is the tech gig. Okay, so always they will advertise on coding contests.
They do host a lot of free webinars too. They create account, that's good enough.
Correct. Yeah, so there is a lot of things they do, but it is mainly known for webinars and job postings, and also a lot of community sharing of code and the competition. Okay. Okay. So I wanted to add a few points to what Madam was saying regarding the hypothesis testing. Okay. So before that, any other questions so far? Pooja, Madam, you have any questions?
Okay.
Okay. Mr. Muhammad Akhtar, any questions?
No, sir.
All right.
No, sir.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about this hypothesis testing a bit, just adding a few points to what Madam was saying. Okay. So suppose I want to test whether I have coronavirus or not. What I do is, I just go to the lab. There is a test available. Okay, I take the test. It turns out either positive or negative. Very simple. Because we have a lab and we can test it. But suppose I am making a statement, as Madam was saying, diet, or let me put it as a balanced diet, increases, or let's take this example, drinking Complan 2 times a day increases height for the age group 5 to 12. Okay. So what is this? What is this now? What is this line that I've written here? From the perspective of the Complan manufacturer, what is this statement? So can we say it is a claim that they are making? Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. It is a claim, or general term that we can use is an assumption. A claim or an assumption. Okay. So this hypothesis testing is almost very close to accusing a person. So when we accuse a person, we say that the person in the stand has been accused of, let's say, a murder. Okay. So it is up to the attorneys to prove that he is actually guilty. Okay. We have to prove that he is guilty. We can either prove that he is guilty, or we will fail to prove he is guilty. We can never prove that this guy is innocent. Okay. It's something like telling a lie. If you tell lie once, then you are a liar. You cannot say, I told the truth the other day. I am a truth person. Truth person who speaks the truth. You cannot count like that. Same way, you either prove him as guilty, or you fail to prove him as guilty. The hypothesis testing is exactly the same way. You make an assumption or claim, and you try to prove it. If you are able to prove it, then your statement or assumption is valid. But most often, we are trying to say whether we can reject it or not. Okay, so let me give another example. Let us say the minimum Right. Increase. You get by drinking Compan. Yes. 2 inches per 6 months. Okay. So now this is a assumption or the claim that we are making. So mathematically, you can say H naught two inches. Okay, H naught is height increase equal to 2 inches. So there is a catch here. Okay, so always, whenever we make an assumption or hypothesis, we use the equal to sign. We use the equal to sign to represent the hypothesis testing. Okay, so what we mean may be more than 2 inches, but when we say that it is equal to 2 inches. Okay, so we don't use a relationship. We don't use greater than less than in the null hypothesis. The alternate hypothesis is simply the opposite of what is the null hypothesis. Okay, so I will explain the caveat in this particular example here at a later point, but let us go with the definition first. So for this particular claim, H naught, which says height increase is equal to 2 inches. So what are the ways in which we can prove this wrong? Okay, I want 3 statements. Which defeats this assumption, which makes this assumption false. So three statements, mathematical expressions I want. Expression 1, expression 2, expression 3. Rajini madam, you can go ahead first. You tell a mathematical statement that shows that H naught is not correct.
I think, hello?
Yeah.
H naught is not correct. H naught, that not equal sign, sir?
Okay, not equal to 2.
Yeah,
perfect. Okay, so that is fine. Okay, Pooja madam, you can tell one other statement that says H naught is not true. Or I can reject H naught.
H naught is greater than 3.
Okay, excellent. HT is, height is greater than 3.
Okay. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah, height is greater than 3. Mr. Akhtar?
Yes, sir. height is less than 2, sir.
Okay, great. Okay. So these are the 3 ways in which we can reject the H naught. The H naught can be rejected by either proving line number 36 or 37 or 38. You can prove that height is not equal to 2, the height increase is not equal to 2, or height increase is greater than 2, or height increase is less than 2. So this is how the hypothesis is formulated. You make an assumption and you make an alternate assumption which defeats the assumption that you made in the first place. So now our job is, for example, I am the manufacturer of Complan, I will try to prove that my assumption is true. Okay. So now for this thing to prove, you don't have, suppose I have 1 million Complan drinkers. I cannot go and talk to each and everybody. So as madam was saying, you may have a complete population. Okay. So can you give me 2 examples of some population? Example of population. Suppose I am making a study of coronavirus. Okay. So I am trying to see what are the symptoms of a person infected with coronavirus. Okay. So I want to see what are the symptoms that occur in India and what are symptoms that occur in other countries. So I cannot go and talk to the 1 billion population. So what I will do? instead of talking to 1 billion, I will take a representative sample which mimics the same population. Okay, so population is 1 million. My sample may be just 1,000 people. Okay. Or I want to say a particular university produces more mathematicians than other universities. So I would take on an average some 10% of the students from the university and try to analyze. It is never, never possible to do a study on the entire population. It is never possible. Suppose when we are trying to give the pre-poll election review, how is the poll turning out to be? I am not going to be talking to everybody who is going to vote. I'm just going to talk to 1% of the population. Okay. So that sampling, there are so many sciences to the sampling, how you have to sample, but we should have an unbiased sampling. Okay. Suppose I am trying to create a survey of people who are going to vote. I cannot just go to one IT company and ask the people, or I cannot go into one university and ask the people, because I am going to be only talking to one section of the people. Literary elite solution, elite population. That is not going to be a fair sample. It will be a biased sample. Okay. So I need to go to different types of people so that my population is a mix of all the things. Okay. So you have to understand an assumption. You can never completely do a survey of the population. You can only work with the sample. Okay. So if you look at a diagram here, so let us assume that this is the whole population on which I want to do a study. Why we are interested in that population? Because our subject is that. For example, I am doing a drug clinical trial on my subjects. So I start with rats, then I do with some other mammals, then I go to human trials. So now, out of 3,000 trials I made, 100 had side effects that are making my study unacceptable. Okay. So I will have always a population on which I am going to impose my study or my results. Okay. So that population is represented by a square here. And the sample size that we are going to take will be a very, very small sample. It can be sometimes 1%, sometimes 0.01%, etc. Okay. So some of the interesting questions that we ask here is based on the hypothesis testing. Let's say I have two samples of people. Okay. So let us say there is a big university, Jawaharlal Nehru University or JNTU, Jawaharlal Nehru Technology University in Hyderabad. So I am saying people who are coming out with very good marks in computer science are not very, very bright in other areas. Let's say I'm just throwing some random information. Okay. So to counter this, I'm taking two samples and doing the studies. Okay. So I have the full population, which is in the full population. Okay. Okay, so this is the sample one. This is the sample two. Okay. So let us say, let us take a different proposition. Okay. So let us say the drug decreases PP. Okay, so let's say we have created a new drug after 12 years of clinical trials and other things. A drug is released. Our claim is that drug decreases PP. So I am taking randomly PP from this sample of individuals and this sample of individuals. So let us say both of these sample individuals have been given the drug. They have been administered the drug on a trial period of, like, let's say 2 months. Okay. So after that test, in the sample one, they have on an average the diastolic BP reduced by 2 for the subjects, and for the group that took the placebo, it was decreased by only 0.05. Okay. In the sample 2, for the people who took the drug, the BP reduced by 2.3, and for the ones who did not take, it reduced by 0.1. Okay. So now the question that we have to ask is, using these two data, can we assume that this will represent the population also? This will represent the population also. This is a very important question. The answer lies in what is called as the confidence level. Okay. So we have taken two sets of people from the same sample, I mean from the same population, and both show that the BP has reduced for the people who took the drug, and for the people who took the placebo, there was not a marked difference in the BP. Does this did this happen by chance, or did this happen because of the drug? So how do we prove it? So if I want to actually prove, my population is, let's say, 1 million people are there. I have only taken 1,000 here and 1,000 here. Okay. So unfortunately, in statistics, we have to go only with probability. We do not have an acid test to prove or disprove certain things. So to prove this, we want to understand about what is called as the confidence level. Okay, so I'm going to talk about confidence level. So majority of the tests that you are going to conduct, like Student's T test or F test or chi-square test, ANOVA test, all are related to the relationship between the sample and the population, or the relation between one sample and another sample from the same population, or things that are different aspect of these studies only, mainly. Okay. So is this point clear? Any questions on this? Any questions related to this diagram that I've shown here? Is it clear? Okay. So I'm going to talk about a simple example here. Okay. So let us say I'm the doctor. I'm a doctor, and a patient is coming to me and is saying that he has a headache and he needs some medicine to get rid of the headache. Okay. So I'm the doctor. So the patient is with me. Now, tell me here, to which percentage I should be convinced before I can give a headache medicine? Should I be convinced that he 100% has a headache, 100% convincing should be there, or is 95% okay, or is 90% okay, or even 60% is okay, I can give a headache medicine? You understand what is the side effect of giving a paracetamol tablet? Okay, so there is not a major side effect, at least there is no acute side effects immediately. Okay, long term there may be things, but I have a patient I have to take care. Okay, so which of these four percentages I have to rely on? Okay, let me ask you the second question, then we can go to the first question answer. So this is related to headache. Second, I'm getting another patient who has either a snake bite or he took some toxic substance. So the problem with the treatment of this particular case is, if I give it to a normal patient, there will be a lot of side effects. Okay. Even for the snake bite patient or the toxic substance patient, the side effect will be there, but the side effect is very less compared to the actual effect of the venom. Okay. So here, how much percentage the doctor should be convinced before he will administer the drug, an anti-venom drug that he is going to administer? 100, 95, 90, 60%. Which of the four is right?
100 will be the right.
Yeah, absolutely 100. Okay. So if not 100, at least 98%, he should be sure that there was a venomous snake bite is there, or he took some kind of a toxic substance. So now going back to the first one, he does not have to be so diligent in finding out whether he has a headache or not. Okay. Even if he is 60% convinced that he is having a headache, he will say, okay, go and take Dolo for 2 days, then come back to me. Right? No? Headache is not a serious disease, nor are the side effects. So with 60% confirmation, I will give the drug. So here, I am looking at a confidence level of 60% is okay for me. Whereas in the second case, I would try to go with 100% or 95%. Okay. Same way, let us say I am going to the shop and buying something and he's returning back 10 rupees to me. Okay. There is some scribbling on the note. I don't care. But if that happens to be a $500 or $2,000, we will look at the notebook in multiple angles. If there's a smallest inclination of an ink mark, we'll say give something else, give a different note. Because you can't go and give it to somebody else if it's 500 or 2000. So we will be extra careful. Okay. Okay. So the confidence level, I'm going to give you an example here. Okay. So far everybody is clear with this, what you are going through. Okay. So let us say I have this scenario. You are very tired of taking rest in the house and suddenly the lockdown is lifted. So you want to unwind. Okay. First thing you'll do is go to the office. Okay. So after 2 days in office, you want to take some relaxation. You're going to casino. Okay. You're going to casino where there's betting going on. So there is a stall where the guest or the host is actually having a small betting. So he is flipping a coin. He has a gold coin in his hand. He's flipping a coin, head and tail. So house has heads. So he always says, I'm going to throw heads. If tail comes, you will win. So you can place your bet. If tail comes, if you are betting 500, you'll get 1,000. If you play 2,000, you'll get 4,000. But if head comes, he wins. Okay, so that is the scenario. So first you are betting something. Let's say you are betting, initially you want to try 100, you won. Again, you want to bet 100, you won. Now I want to increase the stakes. Okay, let's say I put 500 rupees. So first time, it turns out to be head. Okay, so he wins, the house wins head. So two times he is doing it, two times he wins. You lost two times. Third time again he does three heads. So first time head, second time head, third time also head. Now in the first chance, what is the probability that you will think that he is cheating? First time you will think he is cheating?
50%.
50 possibility. So you don't think he is cheating, right? So you will say, okay, it is okay. It is a fair coin. So now our hypothesis is H0 is the coin is fair coin. Now with just one head turning, I cannot say for sure the coin is a bad coin. I will say it's a fair coin. Two heads, can we say it's a fair coin or it's a bad coin?
Bad coin. For two times.
If you toss 10 times, you will definitely have at least two tails or two heads consecutively. it is a possibility, no? So here also you cannot say it is a bad coin for sure. So here the probability of head coming up is 0.5, and the opposite probability is 0.5. Here two heads coming is 0.25, 25%. The probability that it is a bad coin is growing, 0.73%. Three heads, if you are just a friend of me, you will say, hey, you are cheating, man, it's a bad coin. But in a public place like at the casino, you will not have the guts to say it's a bad deal or it's a bad coin. You will have to simply acknowledge that, okay, I think it's possibly possible to have three heads together. So this is 0.125. The opposite probability is 0.875, right?
Yes.
Okay. So now, fourth time, head. Now you want to say that it is definitely a cheating business, but you remember the name of the owner. He's a MP and a minister. You keep your mouth shut. If I am a press reporter, if I know for sure that it is a cheating business, I would be the first one to expose, because I will have more popularity of the channel or the magazine. But now four heads turning up, I will give some benefit of doubt. Okay. I am still not convinced that it is absolutely a cheating business. If 100 times he tosses and 100 times it is head, then I can definitely tell it is a cheating business. But four times, I want to give a benefit of doubt. Okay. So 0.0625. Okay. So 93% chances are there. It is actually a fake coin. Now I am fairly convinced that definitely this is a fake coin. So fifth time, I have five heads, I will call it out. It's a cheating. Okay. First three times, we cannot say for sure it's cheating. It is possible. If you just take a coin and throw it 100 times, you will have three heads or three tails continuously in one chance. Okay. But so now, depending on the stakes, suppose if the owner of the casino is a big shot and he may do some damage to you if it is false, then you will have some reluctance. But four or five times, you can come to a conclusion that it's a cheating card. So now we have 93% possibility of a bad coin. Here this is going to be 0.3125. 97% probability. I am convinced that it's a cheating business. So now the confidence level of the casino being a fake business is 97%. Okay. So you will have to set this threshold. What is your confidence level you want to put for any kind of study? Okay. So for example, I want to diagnose a test, or I want to prescribe some medicine for a disease. So what is the confidence level with which I have to know the information? So I will be doing some statistical tests, and based on that, I will fix a confidence level. For that confidence level, what is the outcome? Okay. So confidence level is very, very important. Okay. So based on this confidence level, we have other terms like alpha, confidence interval, then we'll also be talking about Z score or Z score, depth score. So all these terms are related to the confidence level one way or the other. Okay. We also have a term called significance level. So these will also come in the study of all our tests. Okay. So we'll be talking about the students F test, students T test, F test, ANOVA, or the analysis of variance test, and the chi-square test. Okay. So these tests we will be definitely working, because if I want to find out the accuracy of any algorithm, I need to use some test. Okay. So these tests will be used depending on what type of variable, how many variables are there. We have to choose a test. Okay. All right. So any questions so far? Another term that will be frequently coming across with respect to significance level or the confidence interval level is the p-value. P-value is the probability value corresponding to the confidence level. Like we talked about 95%. So you can say a 0.05 value as the p-value. All right. Because understanding these terms are very important. So if you have any questions, you can ask now, because later on it will be a little misleading. All right.
Thank you, sir.
No problem. I'll leave it to you now.
You'll be continuing with the inferential statistics also?
No, you can go ahead. I think we have 20 minutes more. You can go ahead and complete
that. Yeah. Could you able to see descriptive statistics on my screen?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Pictorially, one more way. Although Kannan sir explained the sample and the population, we take collection of individuals, we form a sample, the larger picture would be a population. That's it. So far now, these are all the terminologies sir was explaining. Now let us take again analogy, inferential statistics. Wine testers sip a few drops of wine to take a decision with respect to all the wine waiting to be released for sale. So it's a kind of inferential. What that one spoon, one sip of taste decides, that is applicable for the entire population. TV networks constantly monitor the popularity of their programs by hiring Nielsen and other organizations to sample the preferences of TV viewers. So it's, this could give you clarity of what is inferential. Descriptive, directly we apply any one of the statistical measure, we will obtain the result or see the value. That value we will be taking decision directly for the considered data. If I am inferring something for any of my students matter, those who are all vegetarian performing mathematics well, those who are all non-vegetarian performing coding skill better, if I am started taking that is applicable. If I apply descriptive statistics, that is, that statement would be true for only my student, not for any other student of this world. Whenever I'm going for inferential statistics, I need to take the data set from minimum 5 to 10 states of the country and minimum 100 to 200 institutions across the country. Then if I start analyzing, if that would give the same inference, that inference is valid only for India, because other country diet would be different. Although vegetarian, non-vegetarian, are vegans, their diet would be different. So it's like that inferential statistics, the difference between descriptive and inferential statistics. Independent variable, dependent variable, treatment with active medicine, treatment with placebo. It's called inactive medicine, placebo effect of people used to do. For example, they will consider two different groups of patients. One group, they may create a pills with a stuff, food stuff. Inside of that medicine, it would be purely a food stuff. It could be anything, any powder, rice flour, dal flour, anything. That they will administer for both of the group. Then both of the group will assume that there is a medicine really the doctor is giving. The placebo is kind of medicine they will prepare, nothing will be inside. That capsule will be filled with a normal diet item, or it would be empty also. That they will administer to the patient in order to understand the study of the particular active medicine. Then finally, dependent variable should tell us, yes, really this medicine has impact or there is no impact. That is what we were discussing, that also IQ, study hours, that all. Through this analogy, we are trying to learn two definitions, dependent variable and independent variable. When we look at this slide, these three columns are dependent variable. This one is independent variable. Look at this collection of countries, age of the purchaser, C, salary of the purchaser or customer. Based on these three, could you able to take decision? Initially, we will get this data for training our model. Initially, this is required. During testing, for example, till 2019 data, if I have about the country, age and their salary and their purchase pattern with my Amazon, or I may run any online business with my online business. If I have data until 2019, what would happen from each and every country, or the moment age, or all the three, if I come to know before even the purchase happens or not, the moment I get to know this data set, my algorithm could be able to predict this guy would purchase definitely with me, this guy would not purchase definitely with me. Something like that I could be able to predict. If you look at this column, it's a categorical nature, yes or no. So it's called dependent variable. These three are called independent variable. Already we discussed enough. Again, we are revisiting formally. Now, in this scenario, can you able to say which are all independent, which are all dependent? The previous case only I'm trying to tell. This is called classification because it has two class. The last, this column has two categories, yes or no category. If we look at this, it has yes or no category. The moment dependent variable is of categorical, it is called classification model. That's what on the title it is there, classification. If it is numerical, this fellow could able to purchase with me $1,000. This fellow could able to purchase with me $2,000. The moment it is numerical, it is called regression model. Very first model we are going to discuss is called regression only. In a couple of days, we will start discussing. For this case, rainfall, umbrella sold. Can you help me which is dependent, which is independent variable in this scenario?
Rainfall will become dependent.
Yeah, month also. Independent variable. Dependent variable is umbrella sold. I am umbrella business owner, or I am doing umbrella, I am the vendor. I may need to think about the manufacturing, the amount of or quantity of umbrellas, how many I need to produce or how many I made it to be available on my shop. For that, which are all the parameter helps me is which month, what is the rainfall, that how many I sold out till 2019. The previous data, only the training data, I could be able to predict this through my previous purchase sale order. This is my previous sale order. Through this sale order, I could be able to predict so that plus or minus 10 umbrellas, I can make it available in my shop. Because once the rainfall started, I cannot even purchase, no. So I need to predict. This is called predictive. This is called dependent variable, umbrella sold. These three are independent variable. Then the moment dependent variable becomes numerical, it is called predictive model or regression model. Whereas previous case, by knowing country of the person, age of the person, I could able to predict whether that guy would make a purchase with my online sale or not. Whereas here, I would like to know how many umbrellas I can sold out depending upon the rainfall and the month. That's why it is called predictive analytics or regression. That slowly we'll come to know by looking at data set and the model, we can able to capture. Now slowly we are entering into what are all the official or necessary steps we need to execute or we need to think of before even building the model. That is called pre-processing. One minute, mouse is not working. Yeah. Pre-processing or data cleaning. After these two steps only, any model we can build or we can think of which model we need to apply. Given the data, we need to first look at data cleaning or pre-processing. These two terminology has lot of steps. It's a major topic. It has lot of steps. Either way we can use. Either we can call it, name it as pre-processing, or we can name it as data cleaning. This is a title. Within the title, we have lot of steps. Now let us see one by one. Measure of central tendencies we need to do. Again, we will be looking into different slides also. Tomorrow for this alone, I'll be using Kaggle course, Kaggle Nano course, which I undergone. The very branded and standard material I'll be using for tomorrow for this topic alone, pre-processing and data cleaning. This is the material I have prepared. So measure of central tendency. Univariate we need to understand, multivariate we need to understand. For example, independent variable which we use for only one, it is called univariate. If the independent variables are multiple, it is called multivariate. These are all terminology. Measure of central tendency we need to look at. For any given data set, we need to find out measure of central tendencies are 5, mean, mode, median, interquartile range, and standard deviation, variance. So many are there. Minimum, any one or multiple combinations we may need to apply and look at. Number one, measure of dispersion and variability. When this fail, I will give you scenario. So time, mean, mode, median will not work out. By the time we need to move to measures of dispersion and variability. When this fails, we should know. Initially, we need to start with mean, mode, median. If that would not give any interpretation, if that wouldn't say anything to my problem statement or data set, immediately I need to move on to measures of dispersions and variability. Then using graphs, we need to explore, we need to look at the data. Spread of the data, nature of the data, we need to look at through graphs. So otherwise it is called, the moment we use graphics, it's called exploratory data analysis. First, pre-processing, data cleaning, exploratory data analysis we need to do. Beyond that, very important topic, what we need to consider is missing data. When we collect data, not necessary that all the rows and the columns are need to be filled. At time, multiple cell values may be missing for a particular record, or single cell value may be missing for a particular record, or entire row value will be missing except one or two filled value. Except one or two entire value will be missing. In such circumstances, how we need to handle the missing data? What are all the methods available to deal with missing data? That is what we need to consider. This alone would be half an hour topic. Missing data handling is till today a research topic. How best we can handle the missing data? What are all the methods available to handle the missing data? Whether we can ignore or not? When we should ignore? When we should not ignore? It is otherwise called one more word, imputation. Handling missing value, otherwise called imputation. So this alone we may need to discuss around half an hour to 1 hour, including coding and all. So missing value handling, this is called preliminary analysis or data pre-processing or data cleaning. Exploratory means we need to explore through graphs or any statistical model, that is called exploratory. Missing value is pre-processing, cleaning the data or something, handling the data, tuning the data, improving the quality of the data. These all we need to attempt first before even building the model. Any Kaggle competition, if you look at the data, they don't give you the data with good quality. They will give very random data or with missing value data, all those things only they will give. First, we need to apply. Most of the hackathon, we may need to handle with the missing data, that how we handle, how we, what technique we use the missing data is also a matter that reflects in the data model. Data model is not a single step. Given the data, directly applying the model and taking result is not at all a matter. We need to clean the data. We need to analyze, explore the data. We need to deal with the missing data. After that only we can think of moving to any other model building. The next is outlier. Let me explain you what is outlier. For example, I'm collecting my apartment weight, apartment people weight of each and every person and the age of the person, whatever. 0 to 10 age, 10 to 20 age, 20 to 30, 30 to 40, something like that, 40 to 50, enough. These are all the, this axis I'm saying it as age. I am putting my boundary, 50 age only I will be considering, not more than 50 I'm considering. Because of that only outlier going to come. What is outlier? Let me explain then. The here weight of the person. Weight. Less than 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, age 40 kg, 50 kg, 60 kg, something like that. I'm plotting the data. The person, the age of 1 year baby or 5 year baby, the weight is 5 kg. All of a sudden, 1 year baby weight is 50 kg. Look at 1 year baby age I am trying to tell, weight I am trying to tell that 55 kg. Something notorious. This is called outlier. Whenever I plot, depending upon the age and the weight, if it falls within the limit, the plots are within this limit, then naturally there is no outlier. It is not out of range or out of order. Similarly, 50 years person age is 50 years. I'm trying to tell a weight of the person is 10 kg. Look at, this is also extremity. This is also extremity. For one more example, I will try to give for the outlier. I want to give a fee concession to my student. Fee concession I want to give my students. Concession. I want to take their family income. If I am trying to tell the family income of my students less than 50,000 per month, I will give 30% concession. How come I know? First, I need to find out the average income of each and every student. If I sit and do, then it will become manual. if I want to automate, if I want to program it, if I want to be like a data analyst, I need to find out average income. Let us take for example, average income comes around 45,000 of 100 students. Sometime really each and every student of their family income would be naturally following 45,000, 35,000 or less than 45,000, whatever. Or else the data set would be in different way. 88% of the family would be less than 25,000 even. Monthly income less than 25,000. Maybe four students' father may be a very big millionaire or rich persons. That four students' family income says that the average income of the family is 45,000. Or even imagine 55,000 also. Not even 45, 55. What would happen? I am putting the claim. I want to waive the fee based on the family income. If it is less than 50,000, I wanted to give concession. Being a computer science engineer, what I wanted to do, I don't want to look at each and every student's manually. I wanted to take average income. My average income says that 55,000. Then what is the meaning is my students are good enough or rich enough. Then I don't want to give fee concession. Not that. We need to plot the data. We need to look at what is happening is 88% of my students are very, very poor, economically very backward family. Just because of four students' family income goes million or trillion, whatever, or crorepati. Because of these four students, the average income of my class shown as 55. Most of the time, outliers create disturbance in the data analysis. That outlier treatment we need to take care. There are different methods we will discuss later. That is called, right now we are trying to understand what is outlier. These four students are said to be outlier. That's all. Because of these four students' family background, the entire class is getting affected. My average computation shows that 55,000 rupees family income per month. That family income wrongly indicated because of four outliers. Family income is wrongly indicated because of these four. That I need to treat or I need to handle. Next, normal distribution. Normal distribution is the basic assumption of entire data science. This is called normal distribution. We will discuss a little bit later what it is exactly. We no need to worry. I am trying to introduce terminology first time. Normal distribution or Gaussian distribution, bell curve, all are same, interchangeably used. Any data or the given attribute, any attribute assumed to be normally distributed. For all the statistical analysis, if not, what we need to do, that is what normalization process, we will call normalization. That also we will discuss later. First, we need to verify assumed to be normally distributed for all the statistical analysis, every attribute or every column need to be assumed to be normally distributed. If not, there are ways to handle how to make it to be normal. Only then we need to build a model. With these three or four terminologies, let us stop today almost 8 o'clock. Everybody would be having commitment. Again, we will continue tomorrow from this slide onwards. So Gaussian distribution, bell curve, normal distribution need to be verified mandatorily. If not, how to deal, we will discuss tomorrow. Is that okay? Missing value, it is simple. Any data misses in the given Excel sheet, that is called missing value. How to deal with the missing value is the second question. Next is outlier detection, outlier extremities, either low extreme or high extreme, extremities. Next is normal distribution. That's it. Shall we stop at this point? Pooja ma'am, Rajini ma'am, Mohammed sir already not there.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, yeah. Ma'am, I have some doubts about these things.
Yeah.
Since I'm dealing with these data about normal distribution, and I don't know about central trend in general. We'll have it tomorrow, ma'am. No problem.
Yeah, tomorrow we'll have, ma'am.
Yeah.
Today, what I'm trying to do is I'm introducing terminology slowly. Because that all that vocabulary is not there for the conversation. Okay. Very tough to explain and demonstrate even coding and all. Yes. It's kind of vocabulary building only we are doing today also. Tomorrow also. The real data science would be started. Maybe it would take 1 or 2 days or 2 or 3 days. We no need to worry. Tomorrow I will be using one more material. Day 3 I will use different material. This is day 2 material, but not even 50% I have done. So much is there. So these all I need to walk through. See, what is mean, median, mode with numerical data.
Yes, ma'am.
Even
yes,
you can go through this very periphery level. Don't dig out anything. If you don't understand, also leave it. See, interquartile range with the data I will be explaining.
Yes, ma'am. The thing don't is, ma'am, I was working with the one model that is ARDL model for my research work. I have removed the outliers from the data set. Even it was assumed that the huge volume of data is not following the normal distribution. So with the plateaucratic and leptocratic values, I have continued with the model. So is it any problem?
Yeah, you can apply log transformation, you can apply min-max transformation, you can apply z-score transformation for or to bring the data to be normal.
Okay, fine. In the model,
yeah, these are all three
different series, ma'am.
Yeah.
As the model
discuss, ma'am, problem statement alone in couple of days.
Yes, definitely.
I am slowly recovering. Maybe in couple of days I'll be absolutely all right with my health.
Okay, ma'am. I'm extremely sorry for disturbing you.
No problem. Actually, this very big fall in my entire life, I can say. More than 12 days I am into sickness.
Okay.
Madam, what is the type of data you're handling?
Yes, sir. I'm handling the time series data.
Okay.
From the NSE and BSC, such data I'm handling, and I'm using the ARDL model so that I can have that long run relationship as well as the short run relationship.
So this is the data of like some cell identification.
Cells. Yes, sir.
So is it diagnostic tests you are doing?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Actually, after the model, I'm doing model diagnostics. Actually, I'm using the eViews software for this, sir.
What software?
eViews. A student version I'm using, eViews.
Spell it.
eViews. V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E-V-I-E- bit, I mean, very few, say 1 or 2% of our knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And I can say I am using Gretel also, which is a freely available software for the time series analysis.
Okay, okay.
But I am comfortable with eViews.
Okay, okay, okay.
So these are the things, sir. Because I'm working in econometrics modeling.
Oh, econometrics modeling. Huh?
Yes, yes.
It is
yes.
Not about pharmacology.
No.
Pooja madam only farmer, sir.
Okay, madam is.
Rajini madam is economic background.
Okay,
economic,
so I am trying to understand what type of data is it. Is it stock exchange? What is the
stock exchange data, sir?
Oh, if you stock are, exchange. Okay, okay.
You want me to share my data, I will share with you.
Yeah. So you have to first decompose the data to train.
Yes. Actually, the data. See, economic data or the stock exchange data is a highly fluctuating data.
Correct. Daily. Correct.
If something is happens, it either go on the negative side or rise like.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I'm just it is not fit for the model to estimate. So we are doing is we are just removing the outliers.
Mm-hmm.
And as required, we want the normal distribution, but sometimes it is assumed that it is not, not
in,
as expected.
In stock exchange, since it's a time series data, so yes. The outlier concept may not be very much applicable. Very rarely it gets applied, but what you do is there is one component called the random noise. Okay.
Yes, it goes
to that random noise, and that can be attributed to environmental factors, like, for example, suddenly the CEO of the company died.
Yes, so all those
things can be actually attributed there. I think we can discuss it maybe in detail later tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Definitely. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, sure.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Kannan sir.
Yes. Okay, thanks everyone.
Thank you.
Mohammed sir, almost we are winding up. We were into small or short discussion. Tomorrow, shall we continue by 6?
Yes.
Are you comfortable or should we change the time?
It's okay, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am.
It's okay.
See you all. Good night.
Yes, good night, ma'am. Good night. Thank you.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye.
Yes.